Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Woodburn Accountants and Advisors webinar series on your brand strategy for China. We have had a fantastic week so far with three webinars that have already taken place, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. And today we are going to hit part four, day four of this series, where we have Ariel Tsai from PingPong Digital, who's going to be talking to us about the five Chinese e-commerce market trends not to be missed in 2021. Very exciting day. But before we begin, and I know this is starting to get tedious for those of you that have been on here already on the last 3 days, but this is truly for Ariel's benefit. It would be great if you could highlight to Ariel who you are. Are you a newbie? Are you a startup? Or are you an experienced China hand? Again, this is to give Ariel some type of background on you. If you would be so kind to also add in if you're a B2B or B2C business, that would be fabulous. So are you a newbie? Meaning, have you found an opportunity for China and you are trying to gain a certain level of education, understanding on how to protect your business? Type in newbie. If you are a startup, that's for me a definition as to companies that have already transacted with China for a period of about 1 to 3 years or have implemented a structure in China for a period of 1 to 3 years, but have been so focused on the core business that all other administrational functions, marketing functions have been put on the back burner. And the experienced China hands would probably be those of you that have done business in China for over 10 odd years, and you're up here trying to gain some new, fresh insights. I'm not gonna lie, I learned a lot of things from Matt on Tuesday regarding mascots, storytelling, product design specific to the Chinese market that I hadn't been familiar with or had even touched on. And he certainly gave me a couple of ideas on what to do as a service provider in that respect. And in yesterday's session, probably the biggest takeaway for me was hearing about B2B apps that are utilized to spread content about one's products or services. And that was a big eye-opener for me. Probably the biggest statement that was made yesterday that was kind of very eye-opening was to hear that on JD.com, services could be sold. And that was specific to the healthcare industry, but I was not aware of that. So again, I'm as an experienced China hand, 17 years in the market, I'm also learning new things day to day. But let me just see who's typed in. Oh, a lot of people, how fabulous. So Andre's a newbie to China, and I think he's B2C. Jihong is a startup, B2B. Steve is a beauty startup, starting off in Japan, then China cross-border. Pui, apologies if I say that wrongly, Pui is an experienced B2B, B2C. Mustafa is a newbie, B2B. Nicola is an experienced China hand. Raymond, startup, B2C. Karen, newbie, B2B. So I think I've gone through everybody. There we go. So let's get started on just the background and technical side of things, guys. The goal of Ariel and I today is to educate you guys. All right. So we're here to spread information and you are here to ask questions. This is a complimentary webinar session. It's your time spent. So we want it to be as valuable as possible, right? Ariel has created a presentation today that is probably a little bit more B2C than B2B, but she has touched on B2B aspects in several of her slides. And for those of you that are in the B2B business, please, again, don't hesitate to ask questions because yesterday's Q&A was predominantly B2B. My promise and Ariel's promise is that we are going to be staying online today until all questions and comments have been answered. So yesterday it went off to a 90-minute session. If you guys cannot stay on, you will get the link to the recording. And if we didn't answer your question or you weren't able to hear the answer, log back in onto the recording, fast forward, and you'll be able to hear the Q&A then at your own time and speed, all right? From a technical perspective, again, I reiterate this daily, I'm not the owner of GoToWebinar. It's a platform that I choose that works very well for me, is stable for me. I understand that some people have had difficulties. If you are working from home, it could very well be your bandwidth, which is why Ariel and I are not using the cameras. It's just you're going to hear our voices and see the presentations. If you get booted off, the sound is not working, my only recommendation is to log off and try and log back in. If it still doesn't work, then listen to the recording at the end of today when I'll be sending out the link. Apologies if you guys went into technical issues. Really, that's, you know, we're not aiming for that to happen, but it does happen on occasion. If I run into any technical issues, it will take me at least 30 seconds to 1 minute to reboot. Please be patient. I will be coming back online. Same with Ariel. Ariel and I are connected via WeChat, so we will communicate if she runs into any sound issues or technical issues on her side as well, and she knows to log off and log back in. So please be patient with us. It's not easy times when everybody's working from home, but again, our promise is to come back on, finish the presentations, and finish up on the Q&As. So be as interactive as possible. Linda, in the control panel, there should be a pop-up which says questions or chat. And in there, you can insert your questions into the questions section or chat into the chat section. It's all in the control panel. All righty, your China experts for the week. So at least you can't see me on camera. You can at least see a photo of me. My name is Christina Kohler-Colucci. I'm head of business advisory at Woodburn Accountants and Advisors. I'm the moderator for the today's session, so I'll be going through all the Q&As. I'm one of the leading experts on inbound investment into China. I've got 17 years of on-the-ground experience being based out of Shanghai in corporate services and corporate compliance. My focus is 100% on foreign investors' entry into the Chinese market, as well as growth. The growth part is the fun part of the business for me. We help people create business models. We help people implement those business models. And then we try to put an emphasis on how to focus on growth. I'm a creator of the China Roadmap methodology. I hold a webinar on this topic every single month. If you would like to join it, the February one is not up and running yet, but it will be by next week. And so if you're interested in joining that, just check out for our website or on our social media links or our e-campaigns, and you'll get the links for that to subscribe. Our experts. So I can't offer solutions on everything. I'm not a marketeer. I'm not a branding expert. And this is why I've got four great people coming on. Matt, who's actually a client of mine, who spoke Tuesday all about the importance of storytelling, creating mascots, and thinking about product design specific to the Chinese market. Yesterday, we had Wendy who came on explaining all about the different apps available for marketing, what would be suitable for which sectors and industries that you're in. Both those sessions are up on the YouTube channel. On Monday, I talked about brand protection. So if you're on here and you haven't done your trademark registrations, patent registrations, copyright registrations, take a look at that webinar. Ariel's on here today, and she'll be joining us next. And then tomorrow I've got Olivier, who I haven't had the chance to market actually because he joined me last week, but he's gonna be talking about budgets tomorrow. What are you expected to spend for your marketing efforts? What is realistic in the beginning, what might be so realistic later on, et cetera. So he's gonna look at that, evaluate that, and give you guys ideas on that. And I'm gonna finish off tomorrow's presentation with just my outcomes. What did I learn out of this? I am a service provider in China. And what were my key takeaways? How can you then develop your brand strategy for 2021? So if you haven't subscribed to that, please do. Link to register is up on our website, woodburnglobal.com/events. So definitely sign up. Now I'm going to turn over to Ariel. Ariel, you can unmute yourself and I'm going to give you control.
Great. Does it work now? Can everybody see my screen?
Yep. We can see your screen and we can hear you.
Great, let me play this. Well, first of all, thank you very much for the introduction, Christina, and thanks for having me today. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to today's webinar. We'll be talking about the five Chinese e-commerce market trend not to be missed in 2021. So before I start, I would like to introduce myself a little bit, although you can't see me, but you can see my picture there. So I'm Ariel, I'm Business Development Manager at PingPong Digital. So PingPong Digital, we are a Chinese digital media agency. We're currently operating from four different locations. I'm normally based in London. We also have an office in Birmingham, Shanghai, and New York. We're a team of 35 people dotted around four different offices. You can see everyone's beautiful and handsome faces here. And we work with brands to help them market to China. So a glimpse of the services we provide as a company, we cover from social medias, including helping brands set up your social media accounts, run your accounts, to pay medias and influencer marketing. We also do websites, mini program H5, and also help our clients with their e-commerce strategy, managing their e-commerce store and their relationship with trade partner, and also digital PR. So what makes us special as an agency is we are the official partner with all the major Chinese channels. So we're official partner with WeChat, Weibo, Douyin, Toutiao, and Baidu. This means we often get the latest information from the platform. If any of our clients want to negotiate a campaign with the platform directly, that's something we can help them with. So a glimpse of the clients we are currently working with. We really work with clients from a broad range of industry, from B2B to B2C. B2C cover from beauty, fashion, FMCG, cosmetic, etc. B2B, we do work with a lot of universities in the UK, US, and EU, as well as like property company, tech company, etc. So this will be the agenda for today's webinar. First of all, we'll look at summarize the 2020 trend and hello to 2021. The five e-commerce trends we'll be talking about will include short video platforms, live streaming, localization, consumer power, and sustainability. In the end, we'll leave some time for Q&A. So first of all, goodbye 2020, hello 2021. What an year in 2020, right? So obviously COVID has impacted the market globally in 2020. It all started from China, but then we are still the one who's currently stuck with it. So in 2020, we have really seen a shift from offline shopping to online shopping, face-to-face meeting to virtual meeting. From this graph, you can see really for everything online, watching live TV, communicating on social media, shopping online, etc., have a huge growth in 2020. 66% of people say they have spent more time shopping online during the COVID-19 crisis. The annual sales for the e-commerce in 2020 in China reached 672 billion. It's a phenomenal number, right? We've also seen a lot of brands who usually only do offline offline retail move their business to online. So we've seen an expansion of product range and brands moving from offline to online. Grocery is especially the fastest growth category in China online. Although we do know that, you know, the lockdown in China doesn't really last that long, some habits that forms during the lockdown period in China has carried on post-lockdown. Another trend we've seen in 2020 is the dominant customer for online shopping is between 35 to 50 years old. I'm not saying that people under 35 years old is not important. They're definitely also a dominant customer for online shopping, but we've seen a shift from, you know, for 35 to 50 become the dominant consumer for online shopping. And a lot of them will use mobile app, mobile e-commerce store to make their shopping online. So if you are already doing trading in China, selling on the Chinese e-commerce platform, make sure your mobile store is compatible to the mobile device. short videos. So we've seen, you know, the short videos trend has been going on for a while, like Douyin and TikTok has been very popular, the dominant social media platforms at the moment. And we think that the short video platforms, the trend will carry on into 2021, and it will become even more important in 2021, which we'll talk more about it in the later slide. Last one is live streaming. So if you're already in the market, you'll probably already tap into the magical live streaming campaign in China. If you're not selling to the market yet, you've probably already heard about live streaming and all that crazy number live streamer generates during the Singles Day campaign. But we do think that live streaming will go through like a shift in 2021, which again, we'll talk more about it. But here is the summarized, it's overall what we've seen in the market in 2020. So what can we expect in 2021? The first one we're gonna talk about is video platforms, excuse me, including short videos and Bilibili. So let's start from short video first. I'm sure we all know about this kind of app like Douyin or Kuaishou. So according to the survey, 78% of the advertiser, excuse me, just need to have some water. 78% of the brands and advertisers in China will invest more in short video ads in 2021. We've seen Douyin coming a long way from, you know, a small social media platform to the mass big social media platform now in China. But why people love short videos is because this kind of quick, snappy, eye-grabbing, very creative short videos really embodied the fast pace of modern lifestyle. 15, 20, 30 seconds video, it's very easy to watch, but it's also entertain people's life. So people like to engage with this kind of content in China, especially young consumer. We've also seen a trend like Douyin try to incorporate this e-commerce solution into their platform. So potentially in 2021, when you see a video, you like the t-shirt, it's one click away, and then you can buy that t-shirt, the same t-shirt as you see on the videos. So potentially short videos and short video platform will be even more important for brands who want to do e-commerce in China. So if you're wondering how e-commerce, how short videos can help with your campaign, I want to show you an example here. So it's a campaign from Michael Kors. It's not a high street brand, but again, it's not a luxury brand. It worked with Douyin to create this campaign together and worked with a couple of KOL to create this engaging campaign with music. And a lot of people just follow up with the same style of videos and really create the engagement for the brands during this campaign period. So I'm just gonna play the video here and I hope you can hear the sound. I've got no roots, but my home was never on the ground. I've got no roots, but my home was never on the ground. I've got no roots. Right, okay, it's very short, like 15 seconds, right? But again, it's fun to participate and it's very engaging. So it's really building that engagement with your consumer in China. And short video is a really good way to utilize for your e-commerce campaign in China. So next one, we're going to introduce a platform called Bilibili. I'm not sure if you guys heard of this platform or not, but it is, we believe, will be the trending platform in 2021. So Bilibili is a popular user-generated video sharing website. You can think about it like YouTube, but it's slightly different. So in the past few years, Bilibili breaks out of its kind of like original anime and gaming niche industry to establish itself as a social network that appeals to Chinese young consumer. It's now ranking number one in the monthly average time spent per devices in China. And we've seen a huge growth of the monthly active user on this platform. Bilibili now not just offer like game and anime, this kind of content, it covers a broad range of different kind of content. And it's targeting at the young Chinese consumer. So if this consumer is your target audience, then you will need to think about, you know, advertising or do some campaign to help you drive your e-commerce sales on Bilibili channel. So Bilibili, what's special about Bilibili? It's really focusing on the user-generated content. So we have a lot of like powerful KOL that share their video content on these channels. It's different from like Tencent Video or iQIYI, which is more like the Netflix style. Bilibili's approach is more about user-generated. So a lot of like what we call 업主, so KOL, Bilibili KOL, will post their videos on this platform. So the Bilibili content is famous for its creativity and the niche contents. The video on the platform really have their own style. So the KOL all have very strong style. They create a strong personal style of the video to share with their audience, and it creates this high stickiness for its user, which means that the audience of the KOL will keep coming back to watch the videos from the same KOL, and they can, you know, comment on the videos, give coins and likes on the video to create that engagement, and also build their own community on this platform. So just a glimpse of different kind of category of video we see on Bilibili, like gaming, celebrity, food and beverage, fitness, overseas education, online education. We can also see some B2B stuff, for example, like investments, technology, review, all this kind of stuff. You can find it on Bilibili. And how a brand can work with Bilibili's KOL, I want to share with you an example here. So this is a very big KOLs on Bilibili. She worked with the luxury brands. I'm not going to tell you who they are, but you can guess that in the video. But you can see in this video that this KOL focused on a Chinese city called Chongqing. She was talking about the old and the new, the past and the future, the main culture and the subculture in their cities. But the videos create this atmosphere, a brand message of the luxury brand she's introducing to the audience. And it links very nicely with the product she's introducing. So it's an 11 minutes video. So I'm just gonna play a little bit at the front and a little bit at the end, but you can go onto YouTube to look for this video in your leisure time.
重庆又称山城、五湖、江城、渝州，虽然称呼一大堆，但对于我这个第一次来重庆的人，这些称呼并没有什么用，因为我对这座城市属于完全没概念。但重庆人给我的印象一直就是包容、直率、讲义气。之前有一位重庆朋友曾跟我说过，有人的地方就有江湖。而重庆其实就是一个江湖，茶还是听一场 underground rap。 重庆会告诉你，尽情的做自己，选择自己喜欢的生活方式。这也是为什么我这次选择在 Jackie1961来到重庆。它和这座城市一样，都是被时代重塑的经典，在保留了传统的同时，跨越时空，绽放新的活力。愿我们每个人都能活出自己 ，Live for yourself。
Right, so you can see just a quick glimpse of the video. It's probably very different from the brand image you will, you know, connect with Gucci. But again, they're tapping to the consumer group they want to speak to in the market. And this KOL provides a really good way to tap into this market using a very strong personality and very strong identity of her own video style to speak to the consumer. So as a brand, this is something you can think of in your 2021 strategy in terms of, you know, marketing through Bilibili platform. So let's move on to the next trend we're going to talk about. It's live streaming. I'm going to quickly play this video. I think it summarized what live streaming very well in the first few minutes.
Austin Li Jiaqi is a 27-year-old beauty advisor turned live streamer and one of the top influencers in China. He once sold 15,000 lipsticks in only 5 minutes. And has a following of 42.1 million fans on Douyin. Each month, he earns over $150,000. This was made possible because of live streaming e-commerce, a rising trend in China. In addition to making stars out of streamers like Li Jiaqi, it's driving billions of sales to e-commerce platforms. So how does it work? Generally speaking, it has similarities to traditional TV shopping. Products are showcased by hosts and sold at discount prices, But with live streaming, there's added real-time interaction. This allows audiences to ask questions about products, which streamers can directly answer. Things sold by live streamers include just about anything. Things like coats, lipsticks, a Maserati, an apartment, and even a rocket launch service. So this begs the question.
Right. Okay, I think that's enough. Maybe not a rocket launch service, but we do see a lot of brands tap into live streaming in 2020. So even before the COVID-19, live streaming has already created consumer excitement around like e-commerce events like Singles Day, Double 11 in China, Double 12. But during 2020, during the COVID issue, we've really seen a huge peak for this industry. But what's more noticeable in live streaming is that during 2020, because of the global lockdown, the restriction on travel, we've seen a lot of B2B brands, companies like property, education, all kinds of B2B brands have tapped into live streaming. Why they utilize live streaming as a platform is not to generate sales, but it's to kind of establish this relationship with their potential consumer and also build up their brand awareness and widen their funnels. So reach out to more people who might be interested in their products and service through live streaming. We think in 2021, because of the technology advance like VR and AR, we'll see more advanced live streaming function coming out in China. But we'll also see more people tapping into these live streaming channels. But the relationship between, you know, all kinds of different marketing tools like social media, your e-commerce channels, KOLs, and live streaming, they'll form a tighter relationship than in 2021. So I just want to show you a quick example about how we utilize this platform for universities or potentially a B2B company. So because university itself, usually they will fly out to China to do recruitment fair once or twice every year, but obviously this is not possible now. So last year, we actually ran a couple of online education campaigns for many universities to help them do this recruitment fair online. And we've seen a great result and success from this campaign because we're able to speak to a wider audience at the same time. There's no location issue in live streaming. We're able to invite professors from different faculties, invite alumni even from different countries, show people around the campus or through live streaming. So as a B2B company, you can start thinking about how you can use this platform to help you establish that relationship with your audience in China. So I just want to share with you some of the stuff we've seen on live streaming. Start from the left-hand side one, we've seen a property company utilize live streaming to sell their property. Obviously, they don't really, you know, expect the sales to happen, but what they do is they are able to share the property live streaming through live streaming platform with their audience. There's also like a Q&A session, so they know what people want to know more, what they want to see more, and you know that more and more people to know about the property that they already have in the market. So it's a really good way to build up that brand awareness. The second one picture we have here, she's actually a top celebrity in China. She's an actress. We've seen celebrity tapping into live streaming more and more now in China. Those kind of top celebrity has now started working with brands. So this is obviously something a luxury brand might be able to utilize in the future, is to work with potential also high-end luxury focus celebrity to do live streaming events together. Right-hand side on the top, that's a university example I've already shared. At the bottom, we've seen like mattress sellers, toilets, bathroom, all this kind of companies start working with live streaming platform to broadcast their products and services. But what should be my strategy for live streaming? I think this is a very key question. A couple of things I think a brand should ask yourself before you do live stream is, what do you want to achieve through live streaming? Do you want to build up your brand awareness? Are you new to the market, so you want to, you know, quickly reach out to a wider audience? Do you want to use live streaming to generate sales? Or do you want to just simply establish a strong relationship with your consumer. Because live streaming can be a great way for a B2C company. It can be a great way to generate quick sell. But how do you keep the sales sustainable as a key part a brand should focus on? Because you don't want to discount your price too much and your product too much. It would damage your brand image. People won't be buying your stuff at normal price anymore. They'll just be, you know, waiting for the live streaming and waiting to get that discounted price. So how do you make sure you utilize live streaming as well as other marketing plan to work hand in hand? It's very key. You can't rely too much on live streaming. Those quick numbers might seem very appealing, but then they don't last very long. So it's important for brands to approach live streaming with a strong marketing plan. That would be the advice I have for you guys. Next one, we're gonna talk about giving your consumer power. So in the last couple of years, we've seen a term coming from the brands and the market in China a lot. It's called KOC, Key Opinion Consumer. So previously, brands would prefer to work with an influencer who have a lot of follower base in China. But now we've seen brands shifting their marketing direction to working with smaller consumers, smaller follower base consumer. But usually these kind of KOC have high engagements and a tighter relationship between KOC and their follower base, which means we can generate a better result through this KOC and we spend less money. So that's a win-win, right? So what we think we'll see in 2021 is brand, you can start using yourself as like an influencer and transform your customer into brand ambassador. We've already seen a couple of our brands started doing it. For example, if they, you know, see some hashtag or ad posts on Weibo or other channels, they've seen some really good quality of reviews or images, videos, the brand will often contact that customer directly and work with them, transfer them into like a brand ambassador. Why this will work is because Chinese people genuinely trust peers-to-peers recommendation, family and friends recommendation. They don't trust brands recommendation that much, but they trust their friends and family's recommendation. So when you transform a single consumer into your brand ambassador, that consumer have the power to influence the like-minded people around him or her and potentially transform them into your consumer as well. So I think this is a key things that the brand should watch out. Don't just work with big KOLs. You need to focus on those small ones who will be able to generate a more sustainable sales and become a loyal customer to you. And just a quick note here is the virtual KOL. I know this has been going on in Instagram for a while, but potentially we think in 2021, we might start seeing some virtual KOL mascot model or start coming up in the Chinese market. We've seen this trend in Korea as well, but I think China in 2021 might be the next market to start employing virtual KOLs into the marketing and branding elements into the market. Next part we're going to talk about the trend is localization. I think this is an old topic already, but I always like to joke about it. Like localization is more than just language translation and currency exchange, right? So in the recent years, we've seen an emergence of like the homegrown brands, like the Chinese brand coming from the Chinese market. And some of them grow very fast and even have the ability to compare and compete with the world brands. But why this happened is because many new brands have actively tapping into the growing sense of the pride in Chinese identity, especially among young Chinese consumers. So the younger generation of Chinese people, they're very proud of the Chinese culture and heritage. They embody the traditional cultural elements into their day-to-day lifestyle. For example, on the picture on the right, it's a trend of wearing this kind of traditional Chinese clothes day-to-day. So you can actually see people wearing like this, walking on the street in China. So I think it's key for brands to understand, you know, your customer, who they are, what's in their NDA, and what's your brand NDA. How do you relate and adapt your brands to the local Chinese audience, and what value can you bring to the Chinese consumer? Because it's not just about, you know, changing your brands into Chinese, changing your website into Chinese. Localization is more than just language translation. So one drawback has, I think, constantly, you know, affected brands to do business in Chinese market is the ability to localize to its culture and the business practice. What brands should know is that each market has its different landscape and different way of doing business. If you're serious about China, you really need to, you know, embrace yourself into its the way they do stuff in China. Like for example, with her luxury brands coming to us saying that they don't want to do live streaming because it doesn't reflect the premium brand position for them. But then at the moment, there are so many luxury products. They're also doing live streaming. They tap into this very trendy way Chinese people are shopping at the moment. This means if you miss out, like in a Singles Day sales or in live streaming, you're missing out the consumer you want to speak to. So it's important for brands to keep in mind that your global strategy sometimes doesn't apply to the Chinese strategy. What works in the West, what works in your previous Western strategy probably doesn't apply in China, and you need to adapt your brand in China. You need to go local. I want to share with you a nice example I've seen before. So this is Oreo. Everybody know Oreo, right? They launched, I think it was 6 different new flavor in China, and it's very Chinese flavor, like you can buy it here. And they created this launch campaign with the Palace Museum in Beijing, created this very localized, very, you know, traditional, but also very creative packaging and tagline for this campaign. And because it's done so well that it really generates a huge attraction for this campaign and the new flavor they are launching. I think it's a great example to show you how a brand can really localize themselves to the local market. Right, so I think this is the last trend we're gonna talk about, which is sustainability. It might be not what you're expected, but we think this will be the trend in China in 2021 as well. We all know like this sentence, I am what I buy. And the global sustainable movement has been going on many years in Western country, but we haven't really seen it in China until about last year, I think. Last year, like the popular brands, like the picture I show here, Pizza Hut, Luckin Coffee, they all participate in the movement campaigned by the Chinese government for the greener development. So it's the Chinese government who's trying to push the sustainability, the greener earth, greener way of living in the market. So we believe in 2021, we'll see more of a strong trend of, you know, like healthy lifestyles, sustainable, anti-animal testing, all this kind of campaign going on in China. Like Chinese government is also discussing to remove that animal testing rules in China, right? So potentially it could be a great way for, like if you're cruelty-free beauty brands, that would be a great way for you to market into China in 2021. So in 2020, there's an Earth Day campaign, and we use a hashtag Earth Day on Weibo, and that actually generated 1.9 billion views on Weibo. And Chinese young audience is, you know, getting to know more about sustainable and be aware of this before they purchase stuff. So if you're a brand, if sustainable is a core value of your brands, make sure you shout out about it when you're doing your marketing or you're on your e-commerce store to let people know this is the core value of your brand. So here comes some of the takeaway. I just want to quickly summarize what we've discussed in the previous slides before. Go digital. So explore online opportunities like website, e-commerce, mini program, etc. For your brands. If you haven't tried digital, any kind of digital solution, if you're more towards a traditional offline events, offline retail, it's the time for you to explore digital because everything will be shifting from offline to digital. So you can't miss this trend. Live streaming. embrace live streaming. Don't be scared about it. I know some brands, you know, are scared about it, that it would discount your brand image. But you just need to approach it in a more careful way, and have a strong marketing plan to support the live streaming activities you're doing. But embrace live streaming, because we believe that in 2021, this will be a key strategy for any kind of e-commerce platform and brands. Short videos are key. If you haven't, you know, been producing short videos in-house, or you haven't been working with short video platforms or KOL who create short videos, it's time for you to try it, you know, just to see how it works. Still live image campaign doesn't work that well anymore. It's moving towards the short video, that kind of fun and engaging video content, which we've shared with you in the previous slides. So yeah, get this in mind, try some short videos content, and it might work a lot better than your previous campaign. To survive is to localize. When in Rome, do as the Rome does, right? So simple as that. When you're in China, try to localize your brands towards the Chinese market and the Chinese audience. Go greener, like our last slides mentioned. If you're a sustainable brand and this is a core value of your brand, don't be shy. Go greener, shout about it. That's everything for today's presentation. For the Q&A session, I think I will hand back to Christina to do that. So just before I finish my site, this is my contact detail. If you want to contact me through email, feel free to email me, or that's my WeChat QR code. If you have WeChat, you can simply scan the QR code and add me. Yeah, that's everything. Thank you very much.
Ariel, thank you so much. Very concise and very, very clear. I'm just going to turn over to my screen now.
Sure.
I would love, Ariel and I would both love to know what your biggest takeaway was from today. I am going to, I took a photo of it while you were speaking, Ariel. I want to reiterate something that that Ariel said that is probably, for me, one of the biggest mistakes foreign companies or foreign brands, whether you're B2B or B2C, do. It's this: your global strategy doesn't apply to the Chinese strategy. Adapt your brand to China in China and go local. You were talking a lot about, you know, doing live streaming. I mean, Matt, so Ariel, you didn't join on Tuesday's session in regards to Matt's session about having mascots and developing virtual models. He touched on that on Tuesday as well, and you touched on it today. And so I wanted to bring that together as well and synchronize that. But there are a lot of things that are done in the marketing world in China that might seem kitsch to you in the Western world, but really it's how you are going to take off and steam ahead in the market. You've got to adapt to what the local Chinese are looking at, and make sure that you get that into your mindset. It is so, so, so critical. So again, we would love to know what your biggest takeaway is. For me, who's developing these webinar series, it's just always good to know also what you would like to have heard more about. And that also then leads on to the Q&A. If you want to book a brand strategy session with Ariel, her details are in the chat section. There's her WeChat ID as well as her email address. And all my details are also in there. So if you want me to make an introduction, please don't hesitate. I'll make that introduction to Ariel as well. So let's get cracking into the Q&A. And we're going to start from the top to the people who actually asked questions from the beginning. So let's get started on that. So Linda was just asking very briefly, will this presentation be available? No, Linda, I'm not distributing presentations any longer because they've been misused in the past. But the recording will be up on our YouTube channel by the end of the day. And guys, if you need clarification on something, please just reach out to Ariel. Have a conversation with her. First conversations are always free of charge, right, Ariel? So, you know, right. don't hesitate to reach out to her. So Linda also had a follow-up question, which was, what is the age group for Bilibili?
Right. I think for that, at the moment, we're seeing the age group for Bilibili, the men dominant user will be under 25 years old, so between 18 to 25. So it's really the younger generation for this platform.
Great. And then the next question is from Astrid. And this is just actually a general question, but I'm just going to highlight here. Ariel, please don't give out fees. But does PingPong Digital have any packages for startups in the B2C market? Do you have startup packages? You know, always the biggest question is budget, and especially for smaller brands that are looking to get into China, how can firms like yours help in that regard?
So we do work with small SME brands to bigger brands. For smaller brands, unfortunately, we don't have a standard startup package because one way doesn't fit all, right? So I'll prefer to speak to the brands first and see what their budget is. According to the budget, we can recommend different channels. If we have smaller budget, I'll usually recommend the brands to, you know, focus on just one channel first, do not widespread that budget. But yeah, we do work with smaller brands. So if you're smaller brands and you're interested in speaking to us, please get in touch.
And Ariel, I do have a question for you on this. And it's just getting your advice on this. So I did an e-commerce webinar series talking about the actual workflow of how e-commerce works, how cross-border e-commerce works in September last year. And, you know, my spiel at the end of that webinar series was like, guys, you can't think about e-commerce until you've started thinking about marketing. What would be your feedback on that? You know, when you look at all the services you're offering and you're looking at companies that are looking to get in China, what is the first step in terms of brand development before even thinking about sales?
Yeah. So that's actually really a really good question. We do have brands who come to us saying that they're already on the e-commerce platform, but they don't want to invest in marketing. They just want to try if they can get sales. And that actually always results in a very bad condition. You have to know there's so many brands competition in Chinese market at the moment. If you don't invest in marketing, really you won't be getting any more attractions. So from my advice, obviously you need to have a solid e-commerce strategy first, finding which platform you want to sell your products on, which trade partners you want to work with, the logistic fulfillment techs, all that kind of technical stuff. But once that's confirmed, you need to really start thinking about how you can support the sales in the e-commerce platform through different kind of marketing channels like live streaming, short videos we've discussed before. But these two things really works hand in hand. You can't really just have the e-commerce platform and don't do anything about marketing because you're not going to see a sales coming through just because the market is so big and so competitive. Why would Chinese people shop your brands, not other brands they know, right?
How would you almost say that for a certain period of time there should just be marketing and no sales? Could that cause a bad image if you can't deliver?
I think if you're a new brand in the market, that's often what we see at the first couple of months. That's when we're building up that brand awareness in the market. Obviously, if you want to see sales, the quickest way is to use live streaming, right? But like we discussed before, how can it be sustainable to bring in that sales with you? So brands will need to know it would take time to establish that foundation for you in China. So in the first couple of months, you might not see much sales, but the money you invest into marketing doesn't go in vain. Into social media, it doesn't go in vain. It's just we need time to build up that foundation.
Right. Astrid had just another follow-up question, which is, what is required to be able to feature on Bilibili? How do you set up an account? I assume that's your question, Astrid. How do you set up an account? And then what is a KOL too?
So Bilibili accounts, I have to say, I'm not sure if you can set it up yourself, but we do help companies to set up their official accounts on Bilibili, which I'm not going to go into details, but you do need to submit some documents to set up your verified official accounts on Bilibili. And the second question is, what is KOL? Is that correct?
Yes.
So KOL is key opinion leader, which is just influencer. but in another term. But yeah, it's just influencer. And in Bilibili, they do have a lot of Bilibili KOL you can work with. So Bilibili influencer.
A lot of questions on Bilibili right now. Jihong is saying Bilibili users are young. Are young professionals included in this group? Just as a heads up, Ariel, Jihong is in the B2B sector.
What kind of young professional are you referring to here? Is there any kind of specific industry you are thinking about?
Well, I mean, her company is an industrial. So I'm guessing she's referencing industrial types of people.
Right. I have to say, I'm not sure about that, but we do see a lot of B2B content on Bilibili as well, because Bilibili is also famous for information and knowledge sharing. So, for example, tech company will use Bilibili to introduce their tech heavy product. Investment company will use Bilibili to introduce their investment products. These are all very B2B focused. But I have to say, I'm not sure if there's kind of like your industry focus on Bilibili. The quickest way is just to go and have a look.
do a search function in Bilibili directly, Jihong.
Yeah.
Patrick, next question is from Patrick. Patrick is saying, the online recruitment fair for universities seems a great campaign. Well done. How did you advertise the live streaming? Was it through paid advertising?
So for how we advertising the recruitment fair, we through different ways. Obviously, the university we work with, they all have their official channels. So we publish contents on their official channels and run paid campaign on their official channels, first of all, to broadcast about their individual live streaming. But as an event itself, we work with Weibo. As we are the official partners, we work with Weibo to help us broadcast this event. Also work with the iQIYI, which is a live streaming platform that's under the same company as Weibo to help us boost visibility of this campaign on the live streaming app.
Great. Guys, please tell us if we're answering your questions. If you want more details, you know, use the chat, use the question section to ask further questions if need be. Karen is saying, we're also seeing B2B companies starting to utilize live streaming to generate sales. Any insights on this trend? How B2Bs could solve the challenges if they use their own e-commerce platforms instead of Tmall, Taobao, and JD?
I think it's always tricky when you are not present on the big e-commerce platform, just because Chinese people, their shopping behavior is slightly different from we are in the West. It's always a bit more difficult to drive traffic to your own website. But live streaming can certainly help, I think. In terms of the trend of B2B company utilizing live streaming, from our conversation, my conversation with my clients in the B2B sector, this has definitely been brought up a lot. They tap into live streaming in different way. For example, if they have a new launch of a service, they were thinking about running a live streaming campaign. And obviously before that, we'll run a series kind of like pay ads or organic content to make sure people know about this live streaming is happening on certain time and certain day. And we can even ask them to register beforehand, just like what we do for webinar. But yeah, I think like my clients has definitely started just thinking about live streaming because they really can't go to China now. So this is an alternative way they're happy to try. But yeah, I think we're definitely seeing a trend in B2B sector.
Very cool. Okay, Alice, who's already left, was asking if we'll get a replay of the webinar. Yes, we're going to post it up on the YouTube channel and you guys will get a link to the webinar session. Karen was asking a further question. Any insights on multinationals competing against local companies? How we could differentiate ourselves if we go more local?
I think it's a really good question. Obviously, there's local brands that's doing stuff in China, but there's also brands who want to break into China. The fundamental difference is your brand images and brand position and brand story, brand heritage. That's how you differ yourself. When we go localization, when we talk about localization, it isn't about you guys giving up your Western identity. It's not about that. It's about how you market to China, speak to the Chinese consumer in the Chinese way. So I think for each individual brand, first of all, you need to know your brand position, your target audience, who is your target audience, what differ yourself from other brands, so your unique selling points. And that's the stuff we can utilize to break into the market through different marketing solutions.
Great. I want to just give in my two cents on that. Again, I'm not a marketeer, but when Ariel was showing that slide about Oreo, first of all, Oreo had a Chinese name that can be good or can be bad, but on their packaging, they still had the words in English, Oreo, and they really localized it to the culture. The packaging, to be honest, when you first brought up, I hadn't noticed Oreo on the packaging, and I didn't know it was the Oreo brand until you actually highlighted it, Ariel.
Yeah,
it just looked like a very local brand, which is what you want people to see when they're going in through the supermarket, you know, is the taste, the flavors, etc. So, Pui is, again, Pui, I apologize if I say your name wrong. Pui is saying, Ariel, great presentation, thanks. How to make the new brands create brand awareness quickly? Is brand seeding in Red and Taobao still important and effective?
Mm-hmm. Well, thank you very much. I'm glad you enjoyed the presentation. It's always tricky when we want to do this quickly because it does take time. But if you want to do it in a quicker way, I'll say probably working with KOL and seeding on Red will be the best channels to use as like a beginning stage. But you have to be careful when you're selecting the KOL you work with. Obviously, KOL can be very expensive sometimes, so you also need to know about your budget. But if you work with some industry experts, that can quickly help you establish your brand awareness in that market in China.
What's your opinion about brand seeding in Taobao, Ariel? Is that...
Brand seeding in Taobao, to be honest, we haven't touched much on that because we don't really work directly with Taobao, so I don't think I'm in the right position to comment that. But in terms of brand seeding in Little Red Book, I do think that's very useful because all that kind of reviews stay on this platform for a very long time, which means people can keep going back to watch that stuff. I do think seeding in Red, it's quite an impactful way.
Good. The question popped up again about the age group for Bilibili.
Mm-hmm.
Can you just re-emphasize that one?
Right, sure. So at the moment, the active user on Bilibili is usually under 25 years old, so between 18 to 25. But they do have user over 25. It's just the dominant user will be below 25.
Okay. Raymond just left, but I don't know if it's a question or a statement or what it is, but adapting to local and the benefits of short videos. Could you just maybe highlight what the benefits of short videos are once again, Ariel?
Mm-hmm. So that's go back to the Douyin example we've shared. So short videos, because, you know, we're so busy in our life now, we don't really have time to watch long videos during our commutes and all that kind of stuff. So short videos provides Chinese consumer a quick way to get away their life. So brands can utilize short videos to create some engaging, creative, eye-grabbing videos, and you interact with your consumer through the short video platform to create a strong kind of like consumer relationship between the brand and the videos, sorry, and the consumer.
Great, thank you. Andre has a really good question actually that hasn't popped up yet, which is, with regards to collaborations with the influencers, what are the most common terms and conditions? For example, do they get a commission on total sales? Do they get a fixed fee? Is the payment immediately? Is the payment after sales? How does that work in general?
Yeah. So there's different, well, every KOL works differently, but the most common way is they would charge it by posts or per video. If you want to collaborate with them for one video, they have a set price for that. So they'll work with you for that set price and then they publish that content for you. Some KOL do work as affiliate, but as far as I'm aware, not much of them, which means you will still need to pay an upfront fee, but it's probably less than the price if you just work with them with one video. But then they'll take a percentage of the sales if they drive successfully some sales to your e-commerce website. If you're talking about live streaming KOL, often they will have an upfront fee and they also take a huge percentage of the sales.
Ariel, this is not a question from the audience, but I think this would fit in right now at the perfect time. I have heard horror stories about KOLs. Mm-hmm. So, you know, whether it's that the video just doesn't portray the image of the brand, because you just haven't watched out on, you know, you haven't taken a look at the, you haven't given branding directives or style guidelines or whatever else, or, you know, they talk badly. I don't know. There's so many things that I'm hearing on the market about KOL. So how do you vet them?
How do you do
a due diligence on a KOL? Like, how do you check them? I mean, how do you check them out that they're really the right fit for you? How do you protect yourself basically in case they do something wrong?
Yeah, of course. So what we normally do when we work with a KOL, obviously, first of all, we identify their style if it fits the brand image. Second, we identify the content, the style, if we think it's a good fit. Then we identify its audience, see the audience group, if it's the right audience group we want to speak to. If we agree on the collaboration, we'll often provide KOL a brief. So based on this brief, we'll lay out quite clearly what they can do, what they can't do, what's our expectation, etc. Obviously, KOL has to agree with that, otherwise we can't work together. But a good thing is you always ask for preview. So before they publish something, you always take a look at it and give them your comment first, just to make sure it doesn't, you know, go too far away from your expectation and they don't speak something you don't want them to talk about. But yeah, usually KOL will be happy to agree to this term. If they're not happy, then just change your KOL. There's so many of them in the market.
In the terms and conditions, are there is there room in case the KOL breaches the terms? Are there clauses usually in those things?
From our past experience, we didn't really include that in our terms and conditions. Okay. I'm not sure about that.
Okay. That would probably be something just from my side that I'd recommend. I don't know if it's feasible or not. I haven't looked at those contracts myself, but it's just something to think about. Linda, I just reposted Ariel's contact information in the chat box, so you should have it now. It was sent to the entire audience. Sherry is saying, hey guys, thank you so much for this recording. I have questions about localization to your marketing in China. We all see that localization can be a two-point sword. For example, in the past, Dolce & Gabbana using the chopsticks or Burberry with the dead family portrait, which were all not positive. You talk about localization, pictures and language is not enough. What are your thoughts and how do you amplify this beyond those two factors?
Mm-hmm. So Dolce & Gabbana, that's definitely not localization. They don't understand. They don't, you know, dive deep enough.
Ariel, let's give a little bit background about Dolce & Gabbana and Burberry and what happened there, just very briefly, so that maybe some people in the audience don't know the story.
Okay, so it was quite a long time ago now. Dolce & Gabbana posted a video about a Chinese model.
It was Chinese New Year last year. It was not long ago.
Okay, feel a long time ago. posted videos about Chinese model using chopsticks to eat pasta and pizza, right? If I remember that correctly. Yeah. And that obviously go viral in China because it's an insult for Chinese people. Why would you do that? That's the point is just, it's not the point. I don't understand how that video even get passed. But that's a really good example of, you know, you don't really know the market. You think you do. They probably think they do know the market themselves, but they don't really dive in enough into the culture behind, the real culture behind the Chinese culture. And that create a backlash on Dolce & Gabbana. And I think nobody, literally nobody is talking about this brand in China anymore. I don't even know if they still have shops there or not. But I think localization, it's always a tricky part, especially for brands who can't speak the language and who don't understand the culture. But it's always, I'll always advise you to speak to an expert about this and, you know, really get their points about this. It's not just, like I mentioned, it's not just about language and image and all that kind of stuff. It's the whole strategy you employ for your Chinese market.
Super. Jihong has a question in regards to IP applications. So Jihong's question is, and it ties in with our presentation from Monday, which was brand protection. In your opinion, Ariel, is it too risky to go to the digital market if your IP registration is not yet completed?
I think this is a question for you, Christina, right? IP. As you're probably in a better position to answer this.
I look, guys, in terms of IP applications and doing all of that, it's up to you to decide if it's too risky or not. You know, if you haven't registered your brand assets yet and you are starting to do marketing in China and you haven't even submitted the applications yet, yeah, that is quite risky, especially if you're going to be spending dollars, marketing dollars, on campaigns in the digital environment and expecting results, and then somebody else registers your brand. Well, you know, like, what's the point in that? You've got to be really careful in regards to, you've got to weigh out the pros and cons in relation to that. I mean, my philosophy is, if you're talking about China, Jihong, you've been on my webinars for a number of years now. If that IP hasn't been registered yet, it's got to be registered. It has to be submitted. Once it's submitted, then obviously it gets less risky because you've submitted the applications and you just go ahead and start marketing. It's just a recommendation for me to do just searches ever so often because, you know, to register, for example, a brand name takes about 12 to 18 months. So you want in that 12 to 18 months to make sure that nobody else has registered it 2 weeks prior to you, for example, which is something that happened to me back in the day. But, you know, again, if you've got a budget spending money on marketing campaigns, whether offline or online, and you haven't registered your IP yet, that's basically money going to waste if somebody else takes your brand name. And no investor or management team is going to be happy if that were to happen. So that's my two cents around it. And don't forget, you know, a lot of the e-commerce platforms, you're not going to be able to work with them unless you've got your trademark or your brand assets registered, because they will ask for proof of that. So just be aware of that. Yeah. Sherry has a follow-up question, Ariel. Or Ariel, I don't know if you've got an opinion on that. I don't know if you want to share something in regards to the brand protection side.
No, I just think it's not just to China. You go into a new market, I think that's the fundamental things to do, really, just to protect your brand, because you don't want your efforts going to waste and somebody realize somebody has taken your brand. But yeah, I do totally agree with you on that.
Sherry has a follow-up question, which is, okay, it's quite long, so bear with me. I have another question about KOLs and brands. We in other parts in Asia have what we call black campaigns. So the trend in Asia right now is where brands are trying to take other brands off the market with black campaigns. For example, brand A will pay a KOL to provide positive feedback on brand A's products and also bring brand B's products to a very negative review. Does this, first of all, I'd be interested, does this happen in China? That's my question. And how do you manage when this happens to your brand, and can it be prevented?
Mm-hmm. That's a very interesting question, actually. I haven't really noticed this, to be honest. So brand A pays KOLs to do this. I think the quickest way is probably to, if you have your official channels about if you have your official channels on Chinese platform, and you already found out about this, and you know this is done through a certain brand, the quickest way is probably just to, you know, reiterate that, make an announcement, not an announcement, but, you know, try to bring some positive review from your past, the KOL you work with in the past, or the consumer reviews. Try to bring that positive review forwards to cover that back negative review. It's probably one way to go. But I have to say, I haven't really noticed this trend in China yet. So yeah, probably not much suggestion I can give now, because
so probably... I'll give an opinion on this for the following. I don't know if you guys are aware, but China has just issued its civil code. This is the first time ever that it's had a civil code. Now, in Western countries, there is a civil code, and I think there is an ethical line between brands bad-mouthing other brands. With this civil code that's now been issued, I think there will be problems if brands advertise that other brands are bad and provide negative reviews. And I think it will all be associated with the new civil code. The civil code has just been implemented as of January 2021. First time ever that China has had a civil code. So it is really coming up to the level of Western codes, Western guidelines, Western ethics in regards to doing business. So I would definitely watch out on how that might get associated if people start bad mouthing brands. Karen has a question, Ariel, for you, which is, does PingPong Digital have experience working with semiconductor companies globally or locally?
At the moment, we do not have this experience in this industry. I'll be very honest.
Okay. Patrick has made a comment which I like. He has seen black campaigns, but not done by KOLs, ordinary people, maybe robots, or comments in videos. Mm-hmm. So Patrick, thanks for your feedback on that. Ariel, go ahead.
One question from the side, if they're still here. I'm just wondering which kind of platform they're seeing this kind of black campaign.
Oh, Patrick, if you can answer that, let us know. Patrick's still online. All right, he might be typing in.
Okay.
Patrick said medium. I don't know what medium means, Patrick. Is that a... Ariel was asking where you've seen these campaigns.
Yeah, is there a certain platform you noticed this campaign has been going on?
He said it's a blog platform, but not specific to China.
Oh, right. Okay.
But it was from a Chinese company. Medium is the name of a blog platform. Thanks, Astrid. Mm-hmm.
Okay, right.
All right, guys. Well, that's the end of the session today. There's no more questions that are popping in. But again, if you guys are slowly typing, we're going to hang on for a bit. Just to end off, please do remember that tomorrow we've got our final session, which is what will be your brand strategy for 2021. Sign up. We're going to be talking about budgets. We are going to be talking about action plans. And if you're interested in that, you can sign up at woodburnglobal.com/events. I have put in all of our contact details, both into the questions section of the control panel, as well as the chat section. So you can reach out to us, and just remember that today's session is being recorded and it will be popped up onto our YouTube channel by the end of today. I want to thank everyone for joining us. Ariel, thank you so much for your time. It was a great pleasure.
Thank you very much for having me today. Thank you.
And I'm going to stop the recording. And again, Ariel and I will just hang on for a couple of minutes in case there are more questions that pop in. Thank you guys so much. Have a great evening, great afternoon, and see you soon.